Welcome back viewers to TV Box Top, the channel for the best reviews in TV boxes and accessories. Today's TV box is the H96 Mini H8, and this box runs on a Rockchip RK3228A CPU on 2GB of DDR3 RAM and 16GB of internal storage on Android 9 operating system. So up next you have my full review and live demonstrations, so stay tuned. Welcome back. In the box, you get the TV box itself, one infrared remote, one HDMI cable, a 5V 2A DC power adapter, and a user manual. Its body is made of plastic with a glossy surface and the H96 Mini branding printed to the top. It has one HDMI port, one RJ45 Ethernet LAN port, one AV port, and the power input to the rear. To one side, it has two USB 2.0 ports and a cooling vent. On the opposite side, you have some more cooling vents and no SD card slot. To the front, you have an LED display. And below the box, you have lots of cooling vents. So I'll set this up and continue. So I'm back. And upon startup for the first time, you are presented with a startup wizard followed by the launcher. So this is H96's standard launcher, and it features these large main icons that cannot be changed, and it has a shortcuts bar. It has a date and time widget, and a one-click cleanup button for freeing up system resources. It doesn't have a navigation bar or notifications bar that comes in handy for users who prefer to use an air mouse pointer. This firmware is built on the Android 9 SDK, and this is its firmware build information. I checked for firmware updates and there was none available at this time. It features a 4K display up to 2160p at 60Hz. However, in similar fashion to the latest Rockchip models, it's limited to 1080p when connected to popular US brands such as Samsung and LG. It has HDMI CEC options, power key definition options, built-in hardware monitor overlay, 52 various languages, and surround sound audio options. Missing from this lineup is a root switch, HDR display settings, Dolby Vision, built-in screen rotation, client server settings, navigation bar, and status bar settings. For pre-installed apps, these are what come pre-installed, and I'll pause for a second and install all the apps I need for this review and continue. So I've installed all my apps, some directly from the Play Store and others I sideloaded using APKs, and they all installed without issues. You have full access to the Google Play Store without restrictions or hidden apps. So for starters, I installed the menu button alternative navigation bar, and it works with all features including multitasking. However, you have to enable it under accessories every time you restart the box due to a lack of root permissions. So first, let's look at its system and hardware information. The manufacturer is a Rockchip, and this is the model of the mainboard. It runs on 2GB of DDR3 RAM and 16GB of internal storage. The Bluetooth version is 4.0. Its CPU, which is the Rockchip RK3228A, is a 32-bit quad-core Cortex A7 CPU clocked at 1.2 GHz with support for 32-bit ABIs. Its GPU is the Mali 400 with OpenGL ES version 2.0 support. Under network, it shows that it has dual-band Wi-Fi support and the 5 GHz band is supported. Its operating system is Android 9 Pie, and it shows that the box is not rooted. Under devices, it shows that the box does not have Vulkan support. Under temperature, the box idles around 85 degrees Celsius. Under codecs, it has all the decoders for the playback of HD videos, and I couldn't identify any digital surround sound audio decoders. So that's its system and hardware information, and from this information, it indicates that this is a budget TV box. So this box is not rooted as shown here by the Root Checker app. and it only has Google Widevine Level 3 with no HDCP protection. This means that premium movie services such as Netflix and Amazon Prime Video will only stream in basic 480p quality regardless of your subscription. It comes pre-installed with the Android TV version of YouTube that has the annoying Google Assistant's voice feature that you can turn off by disabling the Google's text-to-speech engine. It also has challenges playing videos in resolutions 1080p and over with frequent buffering. For customization, you can use alternative launchers such as the new Nova 7 launcher and the ADW launcher 2, and all features are working such as drag and drop shortcuts and the long click menu pop-ups. However, the box has blocked the ability to change wallpapers. When it comes to 4K or 1080p video playback, it cannot play 4K videos because it's limited to 1080p resolution and it does not have HDR or Dolby Vision display. However, it plays 1080p videos just fine, so I will play some 1080p videos with digital surround sound audio formats connected to my receiver.
There goes my toothpaste. I am tired of this.
Left side surround, right side surround, left rear, right rear.
This is Dolby Atmos, the world's first object-based cinematic audio. With powerful moving audio,
so even though it can play formats such as Dolby Atmos, DTS:X, HD Master Audio, and THX, it had lots of difficulty delivering a consistent audio stream with audio dropping at times and video sticking during the playback. As for gaming, it couldn't detect any of my four Bluetooth gamepads, and when I connected them using a USB cable, the box still couldn't detect them. So it appears that there is no Android gaming on this box. Let's take a look at its benchmarks. For RAM and internal storage, it has a RAM copy speed of 828 megabytes per second. Its internal storage has a read speed of 28 megabytes per second and a write speed of 9. In its Wi-Fi and Ethernet LAN speed test, the results show that both Wi-Fi bands could not achieve maximum bandwidth on my network, and the LAN port is not a gigabit LAN port, but it did achieve its maximum bandwidth. In the AnTuTu benchmark, it scored 25,624. This is probably the lowest benchmark I've ever recorded on this channel. Its CPU benchmark recorded a Geekbench 4 score of 356 single core and 695 multi-core. So with its CPU clocked at 1.2 GHz, its slow performance is surely reflected here. In its graphics benchmark, due to its limitation of OpenGL ES 2.0 support, it only qualified for one test and it got an Ice Storm Extreme score of 1427. So this confirms that this box is definitely not for gaming. So after entering the scores on my rankings chart, the H96 Mini H8 is at position 76, which is last on this list. You can view this chart on my blog, where you can view the best TV boxes to buy according to their performance rank. I also provide price comparison links. See the link in the description below this video. In summary, the H96 Mini H8 is an absolute budget TV box. I thought it was going to be a great low-cost solution, but it appears I got more than I bargained for from H96. This is not the box you would want to purchase if you're looking to do anything other than watch movies and TV shows. The cons far outweigh the pros, but you can get it for under $40. And with that said, I've come to the end of this review. If you are interested in this box, you can get it at the lowest price using the link in the description below this video. Give this video the thumbs up if the information provided in this video was of value. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and the notifications bell before leaving. Stay tuned, and I'll be seeing you in the next one.